Good evening again. Welcome, and thank you for joining us on the K-State Carl R. Ice College of Engineering YouTube live Q&A session. My name is Gary Clark, and I serve as the Senior Associate Dean for the College of Engineering at Kansas State University.
Hi, I'm Amy Betz. I'm the Assistant Dean for Retention, Diversity, and Inclusion. Craig Wanklyn, the Assistant Dean for Recruitment, is also with us tonight. He's just off camera. Our goal this evening is to answer your questions related to becoming and being a student enrolled in our college. You might have questions on topics such as majors, career options, salaries, the honors program, cost of attendance, help and resources for students, college design teams, student clubs, affinity groups, study abroad, transferring your college credit, minors, other topics, things related to COVID-19. If you have any questions, please go ahead and type that into the live chat feature below this video, and we will try to get as many of those answered as we can. A quick note, we are hosting in-person campus visits Monday through Friday. So if you haven't been able to come to campus and would like to visit, you can still schedule a personalized campus visit online through K-State's website. Okay, let's get started. We have a lot of great questions sent to us by email, so we will answer a few of those first and then get additional questions in the chat. First, a major topic has been COVID-19. So, Associate Dean Clark, what is K-State doing to help students stay healthy?
That one's been around a lot. So one of the things we're doing, we all wear our masks. Our faculty wear their masks. Now, some faculty wear face shields in classes, but while they're in the buildings, they need to wear their masks. The other thing is that in the classrooms, we've got physical distancing of six feet or more between students in the classrooms. But we still have a lot of in-person classes going on this fall, more this fall than we had, or this spring, excuse me, more now than we had last fall. And then at each of the doors inside our building here and the various buildings on campus, there's automatic hand sanitizers. So students can come in, put their hands under there, get some hand sanitizer and wash off or sanitize their hands before going in. So there's a lot of opportunities to keep healthy. As long as we really pay attention to wearing the masks and sanitizing our hands, things go well. I see another one that's any advice for students that go to school next fall in light of the current pandemic? You know, that's another one. And we get a lot of student clubs, Amy, that they ask, when are we going to be able to travel again? What's it going to be like next fall? And right now, I mean, we just don't know. But my advice is just plan to come here. One of the best things is just go to class regardless, whether it's in person or if it's online. Got to have a schedule, right?
Yes, making a schedule, staying on top of your schedule, making sure that you're balancing your in-person experiences, right? If you have a class that's online, one great way to sort of connect with people in the class would be to use our tutoring resources, right? We have our scholars, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, but we have scholars assisting scholars. They have in-person sessions for things like calculus, calc 2, calc 3, all the physics and chemistry classes that you're going to take. So you can come in and see some of your peers and work with, you know, one of our tutors as well, so that you're also getting that help staying on top of the work in your courses.
Right. So again, paying attention to all those rules and regulations that are in place because they're helping us all. Along those lines, I have a related question about COVID in relation to residence halls. They're all open and they're doing quite well. Even the dining centers are open. And I was just looking a couple of weeks ago to see how things were going. And the dining centers have options for students that, you know, they've kind of like got their own family groups where they can eat in a small group together in the dining halls and they spread them out. So they've got things figured out. And as I remember from last fall, there were no major issues in the dining halls and the dorms. They know what to do and they took care of things.
So another question we had via email was about opportunities for study abroad. So this is a big question because it's actually a great opportunity that our students take advantage of. We can't travel just yet, but that doesn't mean you can't plan for your study abroad opportunity. And these are actually really best to do in your sophomore, junior year moving forward. So when you come to campus this fall, You can meet with the study abroad. We actually also offer study abroad program to come and talk into a lot of our classes, and they can talk with you and you can start planning, and hopefully we'll be able to travel in that sophomore junior year if you're looking for that study abroad opportunity.
I would highly encourage that. Yeah. So I am a very strong proponent of study abroad. They call it education abroad now too, here as well. But it's a great way to really get a whole different experience. But as Dr. Betz pointed out, start planning now, get a passport. It's not gonna expire by the time you need to go. So get that passport, get that process going. And then when you're here in the fall, start asking questions, and we'll have some of those sessions. But they're actually gonna open up a few, or looking at opening up a few education abroad opportunities this fall. And the other thing that's great is that we have a lot of exchange programs, and students can go to an exchange program and they'll pay the same as they pay for in-state, K-State in-state tuition here now. So it's quite a bargain.
Yeah, and it's just a really great way to get a better global perspective. Also about not only just a global perspective in general, but also about the field of engineering, especially if you're able to take engineering courses in another country.
So we have a question from Jack, and Jack says, what types of ways does K-State connect students with engineering companies to help them get employed? We just had our College of Engineering career fair in the spring. Now we have two career fairs, one in the fall and one in the spring. The spring is college only. And I think we had about 100 different companies. Now, usually it's inside this building and they're all here. This year it was a virtual event, but we still had over 100 companies, and they had they work with our Career and Employment Services office through things called Handshake and other things to get those students connected. And some of our departments also have special sessions with companies that come to visit their students in the evening and have all kinds of engagement events. And we've got one coming up tomorrow with ExxonMobil, as a matter of fact.
Yes. And then we've got another question that came in. It's similar to study abroad. And actually, Gary, I'm going to ask you because you know this one. It says, I think you have an Engineering Without Borders chapter here at K-State.
We do.
Can you tell me more about what they do and how is that similar or different to study abroad?
Sure. Engineers Without Borders, it's a fun group. And in fact, I work with one of the teams on there. These are students from across the college, but also from across campus that come together, and they've got three projects ongoing right now. One is a project to supply or develop a kitchen for a community in Guatemala, I think it is. And then they've got two projects in Nicaragua. They're not traveling right now. One's a small irrigation project and one's a clean water supply project. But this is a great way to partner with communities in a broad sense. And we have just struck up an arrangement with a professional consulting firm in Kansas City that also does a lot of this, that's going to be working with these teams. And by the way, if you're worried about them traveling abroad, we don't go anywhere until it's safe, whether it's the pandemic or other things. So we don't travel to unsafe areas, but we may do things remotely. Well, so, I'm going to ask you this one.
Yes.
What about students getting a minor in another school, such as business? What do you suggest about that?
Yeah, so we actually have lots of students that get minors, and it's a great addition to your engineering degree. So part of this is also to prepare a little, you don't have to be ready for it right away, but maybe your first year at K-State to start thinking about it. You'll have some open elective classes to take some electives that'll count. A lot of students do a business minor. We also have over in the School of Business a marketing certificate. There's lots of other students get a minor in a foreign language as well. So these are all, and there's also leadership studies program. I think these would be some of the most common ones. And a lot of them work already. So it's just maybe one or two extra classes you have to take on top of your curriculum already, especially the business minors. Most of the departments have a flowchart planned out, which shows you exactly how to get that business minor with as few extra classes as possible. It's really great for engineers, I think, to have a little bit of that additional perspective. A lot of them end up working later on in management or even going for an MBA. And so it's especially if you think that might be the long-term career path you're going to take, it's a great.
Well, I'm going to tie back into study abroad or education abroad, because I'll often get students say, hey, I want to do a minor in Spanish or maybe a minor in French. And I will say, go do a study abroad in those countries, because the question is, Do you want to really know the depth of that language? If you do, then absolutely, by all means, do that minor. But, or if you just want to learn how to speak that language better, then go do a study abroad, because it could take 20 hours or more to do that minor. And as Dr. Betz pointed out, there's other ones you can do with one or two extra classes. But by going and living abroad and then living in that culture, many of our students will live with host families. And do that.
And we just saw in the chat that a student was asking about academic advisors. This is a great, right? You'll get an academic advisor your first semester here. You'll meet with them to talk about coursework, but it's great. Come to your academic advisor with your questions about, you're thinking about a minor in this or study abroad, and they can help you really navigate how to make the best of all those different choices, right? Whereas maybe you're looking at two different minors. Maybe you don't need to do both. You do a study abroad and the business minor. And then you've actually met all of your career goals, and you've done it in, you know, sort of the, I don't want to say, you know, in the, not the easiest path, because nothing is easy, but the path that works best for you in meeting those goals. So that's definitely a place where you're going to want to meet with your academic advisor and share those goals with them.
I'll take this other, there's a question from the chat about student health and COVID testing and vaccines and general student health. First of all, we have the Lafine Center here. It's our Lafine Health Clinic here, and it is awesome. They have excellent medical personnel there. COVID testing, I've actually gone a couple of times myself, because they open it up to faculty staff, and sometimes I've got my results back within that day, and sometimes it's just taken a couple of days. It depends on which door you need to go in, but they have great resources there, and we're going to be set up, K-State's going to be set up to be doing the vaccine once we get those. Now, it's going to take us a little while because the whole state is going through their process. But overall, there's great facilities for student health here. And they have processes available for students. So when a student does come down and needs to quarantine, they've got options to help students out too, especially in the campus housing options. So, okay, I see another one. How do you assist students in getting internships? That's another one that goes back to the departments and a lot of those connections, but that's where Career Fair comes in. And I think we advise students as freshmen to go to Career Fair.
Yes, you start as early as your first year, right? I usually tell students that first fall with the university-wide Career Fair, that's just when get your resume together, go to Career Services, make sure it's looking good, and start meeting with these companies to learn more about it. When are they hiring for internships, right? Because there are some companies that'll hire after your first year. There are others that really wanna see, you know, 2 or 3 years experience, right? So find out what are the companies that are gonna hire an intern in that first or second year. Come back and see them again in February at the engineering career fair. And you can always also just apply online places, but you will find every department has some different resources as well, right? Architecture and construction science, they keep a job board all the time, job postings. But we also constantly have companies reaching out through the departments, and there's departmental emails sent out telling you what companies are looking for interns in your major.
So you just said a word that all students need to pay attention to. Email.
Email. Yes.
Read your email. We try many ways of communicating, but there's a lot of great information that comes out via email. I see emails every day from department heads about opportunities for internships. So students, you got to read those emails. K-State email, pay attention, right? I see another one about this student-teacher ratio in engineering classes. That's going to vary. So some of our engineering science classes, like thermodynamics and statics, those are kind of lower, the earlier mid-career student level, we'll have a couple of hundred students in a class, usually there's maybe 120 to 150 in a class. But we also have student tutors and things that help with that. Upper level classes are usually smaller, and they could range from 60 students in that class to maybe only 15 or 20. It just depends on the class. So it's just going to be balanced. Now, there are classes, though, those first couple of years when they're in calculus and physics, and those have, I mean, a lot more. There's some big sections, but there's also recitation sections.
There's also recitations. There's also, for those larger classes, lots of, we had another question about academics, testing prep, and tutors.
Mm-hmm.
For those larger classes, we also, there's tutoring both through the math department and through engineering for classes such as your calculus 1, 2, 3, differential equations, chemistry, physics. And these tutors meet with students one-on-one in small groups. They're available for walk-in availability. We actually have them both doing walk-ins in person and via Zoom for students that still want to be doing things for distance. Actually, or we found sometimes it's just a lot easier for students to fit that Zoom in. They've got 20 minutes in between two classes, and one's here and one's there, or mm-hmm. they're back at home because both those classes are on Zoom. It's just much more convenient to be able to log on, and we're actually using Microsoft Teams for the tutoring. It's just much more convenient for them to log in and connect with the tutor there.
So that's part of SAS.
Right.
So what is SAS?
So SAS is Scholars Assisting Scholars, is what it stands for. We use the acronym SAS Lab. And it's just other peers in the College of Engineering. These are students at junior, senior level. They've completed most of the classes. They've got B's or better in most of them. And they're just they actually attend the same lectures that you do in your class. So even if they took the class with a different professor, they're well aware of what your professor is teaching in that current section. They offer tutoring. Maybe each tutor is available 5 to 10 hours a week. And for some of our larger classes, we have multiple tutors. And they also do reviews before all the exams. So we can always tell when it's getting to be that time because students get a little bit more, you know, restless in the building. Even now with less students, you can kind of tell it gets a little busier all of a sudden when those calc and physics exams are coming. There'll be a review. The SAS tutors they work with the instructor to know what material is going to be covered on that exam and provide a review before the exam. So we're making sure that all of those classes, sometimes the professor does a review too. Sometimes that class, they just have too much material to cover and they can't do reviews in the class.
Mm-hmm.
So this really ensures that you get those reviews before each of those major exams.
So key things to remember, we always tell students, go to class, go to SAS.
Really important. Read your email.
And read your email. There's another one about double major, and if so, is it common for students to double major? Would you look at an engineering and a computer science double major? Is it realistic? And I'm going to go back to what Dr. Betz said. Talk to your advisor at that time and just ask around. In some cases, yes, but I always say, you know, you need to look at what do you think you're going to do in the future that double major may be of value for you. And if you're going on for grad school, maybe double majoring is not the way to go. You might get a major here, and then as you go on to grad school, look at that other area to major in for grad school. So I don't worry about double majors too much now, unless there are certain circumstances where it can make a lot of sense, and it's one or two extra classes, you get some extra expertise in some areas, and it's just kind of like a minor.
Yeah. I would second that. Talk to your advisor. And also when we're going to the career fair, ask what those companies are really looking for and what's valuable. Because most of the time, something like an engineering degree with a computer science minor is going to get you all the skills that double major mm-hmm. might get you. There are some other ones that are kind of popular. I would say a double major with engineering and mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
It's really only a couple more classes after the mathematics minor. So we have students, if you really enjoy it or you want some specialized skills in mathematics, right? So some of our curriculums don't have as much statistics, right? So if you're just going to build on some of your statistics background with your degree, that's enough to get you that double major. And that can be seen as a beneficial skill. But yeah, you really just want to, again, it goes back to what are your long-term career goals and how is this going to match them? But again, I also go back to if you're interested in it, you know, go ahead and do it because then the career path will work out. But I don't feel like anyone needs to double major.
Well, you mentioned companies. There's another one related to companies and internships because a question in the chat was have engineering companies and their prospect for students slowed hiring due to COVID? It has slowed a little. Last fall was slow, but we got busier. It all got busier this spring and it's picking up. And my experience is showing that the work is not slowing down. So quite honestly, if we're looking at new first-time, full-time freshmen coming in this fall, they'll be graduating, you know, 4 to 5 years or so after that. Hopefully we're done with all this pandemic stuff, I mean, by then. And I really think that in this next year, the job market, which was super strong before COVID, is gonna just explode and open up again. So and by the way, a degree in an engineering field is always a solid investment. whether even if you don't even go to work in the engineering field, there it opens up other doors for you. It's just a good investment for your future.
Yeah. And we always see there's always a little variability year to year, and that's why having a couple options is always good, right? Right now, things like working in aerospace or, you know, for some of the gas and oil companies, they're a little bit lower right now, especially aerospace. But other companies, right, that do sort of consulting, or anybody that works in any sort of building or construction or things like that, they are actually doing quite great. And, or people that work in, you know, rail or shipping, or there's all these different fields that right now are actually booming. Computer science is another great one. And it'll just sort of go, some of these go in waves. And so some years it's a lot of hiring, the next year not so much. But the other thing I also tell students is you don't have to find your dream job in that first job.
That's right.
I don't want you to get too worried, right? Some of my students are, oh, it's been my dream to work for Boeing and things aren't going, you know, it's not a good hiring season right now. Well, just go find something else that's going to help you build your resume. And when it comes back, you can always look for a job again, right? It's also about just that, you know, always trying to move your career forward.
There's another one off field here. It's about scholarships and are they still available for prospective engineering students? And there are award letters that are going out now. So if you have applied to the college, we're aligning those with certain scholarship categories that the campus has given as well. So those will be sent out pretty soon. But also the K-State Scholarship Network deadline to apply for scholarships is March 15th. So please go into that. And so we have some scholarships coming out. And then once you're here, then other scholarship opportunities within the college open up because we give awards for involvement, for leadership. If we have students that are first gen to college, we have awards for them. We've got a variety of awards that fit with different departments and other activities. So get on that K-State Scholarship Network and apply. I've got one for you I'm seeing up here about transfer credits and Calc 1 or Calc 2 or Calc 3, and where should I start?
Right. So the specific student is talking about they've taken Calc 1 and Calc 2. Should they start in Calc 3 or should they go back and redo Calc 1 and Calc 2? It's going to vary for every student, but I think for this particular student, I would say maybe start at Calc 2. And if you've taken Calc 1, you might want to think about doing it over, right? So whatever your most recent math class was, depending on how you did, maybe going back and doing that Calc 1, because again, you've learned the material, but those college classes, they're going to move a lot faster. They're going to cover some things you didn't cover before, right? And you're also going to learn a little bit more about how are these courses taught and what are the expectations for the testing, right? Because I think a lot of students are, you know, there's a lot of adjustment about, you know, keeping that schedule for the class and keeping on the testing and what's covered and the amount of material that's now covered on a test. And I think it can be really helpful to have a little bit of overlap that just acts as a little bit of buffer while you're adjusting. You don't have to go back and redo it all, but, you know, to feel comfortable that you're not going to be overwhelmed because, you know, you're going to be taking a lot of classes that first semester. And so kind of balancing getting ahead and using some of those transfer credits with being well prepared is what you want to look at. And the other thing I would caution about the math is it doesn't do you that much good to get too far ahead in the math because you have these other classes, physics and chemistry, that you kind of have to move along with it. And if you get too far ahead, if you start out in Calc 3, it's going to be a long time before you actually get to the class that applies it. So one semester off isn't going to hurt you, but if you start getting two or three semesters ahead in the math without being ahead in those other classes, it's going to throw you off. You're not going to be in the same cohort with a lot of your peers, and it's really just not helping you as much to actually graduate any faster.
Well, there's a math placement exam.
Yes.
So there'll be a math placement exam. You'll get some information on that. It's not pass-fail. It's just it's an online test that you'll take. But the whole idea is to see how ready are you for the different levels of math. And our goal is to get you placed in the right math class. So you may come in with the idea of starting in one level, and then when you get here in June and you've taken that math placement exam, we've got very skilled advisors that are going to work with you to put you where you're going to be the most successful. That's what we want. We want you to be successful. As Dr. Betz said, students are transitioning. They're away from home. It's just a whole new lifestyle. There's a whole lot to learn. So kind of going over and getting a refresh on some things is a good idea. I see another one that I'll touch on. Will college credit transfer with the grades that I received in high school, and where would my K-State GPA start? It'll start at zero. Basically, well, actually, everybody starts with a full A, all A's, yeah. Right?
It depends, right? Are you an optimist or a pessimist? Right, so right. 4.0 or zero.
But basically, the credit transfers in, but the grades do not transfer in. Okay, so just transfers in as college credit, but the grades don't transfer with those. And same thing goes, is that we have students who say, come here, and they're here for their first year, and then they go back home for the summer, and they're working near home, and there's a community college or a four-year school near home, and they may take some classes from there and then transfer those in. Same thing. You got to get a C or better, but it only transfers in as credit. The grade does not transfer with it. And if anybody does that, when you get down that road, always talk to your advisor, because we want to make sure whatever classes you're taking and paying for are going to come in and count towards your degree. Let's see. Oh, another one about some schools switched classes to pass-fail due to COVID, and did that happen at K-State? Yeah, we had that. You had some students. But it was only last spring.
Only last spring, yes. Okay. And students were allowed to. We actually had a slightly different model. We have an A pass-fail. Mm-hmm. So that way, if you end up getting that A, you still get that GPA boost from the A, which I actually think was really great for students to still have.
But that's gone.
But it's gone.
It's gone. It was only last spring.
You actually still always have that option, but it's usually you can only take it for classes that aren't within your department. You can do it for some of your elective courses if you wanted to opt to take them A pass-fail. But we don't see a lot of students using that option.
So another, will we see more freshmen? Question is, are we gonna see maybe more freshmen this fall since many students took a COVID gap year? And that's a possibility. I hope so. It was pretty quiet last fall, although this spring is looking great. I mean, yes. Our parking lot's full. We're seeing students all throughout the building. It's so much better. I think so. Now, I think our biggest freshman class was about 850 students a few years ago. Last fall was 650. I'm going to guess we're going to be maybe around 700, 725 this fall. So we'll have not as many as we did a few years ago, but I think it'll be a good number, and a number that's quite manageable. So I think we'll have a good number of students coming in.
I think we'll have a good number of students coming in, but that we'll still have plenty of resources. There'll be space and tutoring. I think what we see from companies, like Dean Clark said earlier, it was a little slow hiring, but when he says slow, he really just means the process was a little slow. Mm-hmm. And I think because companies were waiting, we still see the hiring continue. There's a constant demand for engineering graduates. So we will be delighted if we have a slightly larger class, because we really do need it to continue to meet the demand for people that come.
The work hasn't slowed down.
Yeah.
I mean, things that engineers do in a variety of things, whether it could be the food supply chain, it could be the manufacturing chain, things change, but even with aircraft or roads or IT infrastructure or electronics, all that stuff is still going on, and those companies have adjusted. Mm-hmm. Now they're working on how to get those new persons in. So that's picking up.
Yeah, and I will say companies actually have been, a few that I've talked to and some of our graduates that have recently been hired, they're actually really excited about the new skills that the students are bringing in, right? I think maybe the companies have adjusted more, but especially last spring and last fall, the students were on top of, like, they knew Microsoft Teams, they knew how to navigate Zoom, they knew how to do all these tools. Mm-hmm. When companies hired them, they were like, great. Teach us all how to do it and how to make us run more efficiently in this remote environment as well. So we're always going to need a highly skilled workforce, and the College of Engineering is always going to help to provide that.
There's another, how do we help students in getting internships? So we have a variety of company sessions where they come, but I also want to bring out, we have a liaison with the Career Center on campus. And we have help with setting up a resume. So they come over, they talk to students, here's how to get your resume started. Even as a freshman, here's how to get your resume started. We haven't done it this year with COVID, but in normally other years, we have mock interview sessions that company reps will come in and they'll do mock interviews to help students get prepared And our campus representative with the Career Center will come over and give them all kinds of pointers, even how to dress, okay, how to dress appropriately, how to present yourself, what kind of questions you should ask. So we have lots of preparation options available for students for internships, in addition to just getting them in front of the companies, but how to get ready so that they can have a successful interview. I'm going to let you.
So we have another question here via email is, what should students do to be prepared for engineering? And I think this is a great question, because we definitely want you to be prepared and we want you to be successful, but I also want you to enjoy your life, right? I'm a big person who believes in balance. So I think, right, one of the key things, and if you're not quite there yet, don't worry about it. But if you are in a position to be well prepared to start in Calc 1, when you first come to K-State, that's going to be a plus, right? If you're not quite there yet, that's okay too, but that's really going to help out. Think about your study skills and what you can do to help build those study skills. Think a little bit about, you know, what's going to help keep you motivated when you come here, and what are some of the things you're going to need, and have a plan about when you're going to go back to, you know, back home maybe, or some of these other things really help students out a lot to kind of talk through what life is going to look like when they get here at K-State as much as possible, and talk to, I know you have friends that have started at K-State, so you can talk to them as well about it. I think those are the major things, but yeah, also make sure you enjoy that final year of high school though. I think that's very important.
And part of enjoyment is being involved.
Yes.
Not just, so yes, you got to go to class, got to go to SAS, got to answer email, but also have fun. So we have a lot of students who go into the K-State Marching Band. And in fact, if you take the K-State Marching Band, take the music majors are half. So that's half of the marching band. So the other half of the marching band, half of those are College of Engineering majors. So 1/4 of the marching band are there. We also have students who are in the various choral programs. They like to sing. Okay, and they sing. We have students that get involved in intramural sports. And in the college, we have all kinds of competition teams, design teams. We talked about Engineers Without Borders, but there's so many others. If you like to tinker and build things, we have an e-club. We have, it's an electronics club, but we have the Baja car, the Formula car, the Chemi car, steel bridge, concrete canoe. But then we have cyber defense club. There's just all kinds of student organizations and professional clubs to get involved in. And that's an important part of your education in addition to the class.
Yes, absolutely. It's all part of that K-State experience, but it's also all about, you know, getting you all these experiences that are going to serve you really well in your future career. Right. And it's also about making connections to people you're going to know later in life.
So, question about any way to pre-plan for first-year courses prior to orientation and enrollment. I mean, really, just it's looking at the curriculum.
Right.
A lot of it's, you can look at the curriculum and see, you know, see what those courses are going to be. But people are going to be here. They're going to look at your information, and they're going to help guide you as to what that best course load is. And that course load, typically, it's around 13 to 15 hours max that first semester. Now, that doesn't mean just 13 hours a week is all you're doing. There's a lot of study time and review and preparation time outside of that.
Yeah. And I think you can probably do just a little bit of thinking, because the curriculum in that first semester, there are certain courses you need to take, it's probably best to take. I shouldn't say need. They're best to take to sort of stay on track for your major. But there are some you have some flexibility with. These are courses like English 100, macroeconomics. There's some other ones in there. So you might want to think about, what am I actually going to enjoy? So if there's any flexibility in there, right? I think it really helps to think about what you would like and you're going to enjoy to take, especially, again, we talked about this transition. The more you're enjoying the classes and you want to go to those classes your first semester, the easier it's going to be for you to stay on top of your schedule.
Another question on scholarships that might be available for students once they're already here, and my advice is, be involved, get to know the faculty in your department as well. We have several that we give out for involvement and leadership. And by the way, the scholarships, the vast majority of them are dollars that come from alumni. And that's where they, for us, they, in different areas, they're from different things, but for us in our college, it's our alumni that give those scholarships. And some of them say, I want this to go to students who are active and involved. I want this to go to students who are in electrical engineering only, or I want these to go to mechanical engineering majors, or it doesn't matter. I want this to go to students who are working a part-time job. I want this to go to students who have financial need. I want this to go to high caliber, you know, top GPA students. So there's a variety of things, and that's where coming into keep that K-State Scholarship Network application always up to date and with all your new activities, because we review those every year.
Okay, well, it looks like we have a question via email from Amy. So since it's from another Amy, I'm going to go ahead and answer it. When do students find out their advisor? So when you come for, or we're going to do it virtually, when you have enrollment, you'll meet with an advisor in that department who will help you for that first semester. And then once you come to K-State, you'll actually be given an academic advisor in your department. And you'll meet with them, you know, about 8 weeks into the semester to start working on your enrollment for the next semester. So you'll know as soon as you come to K-State. But you'll meet, it may end up being your permanent advisor, or it might not be, but it'll be another faculty or advisor from your department that will meet with you during enrollment.
And then we've got a question from Mason about transfer students, and do they get any kind of priority, enrollment priority, depending upon how many credits are transferred? Yes, eventually. Yes,
that's a good question.
The first time, not yet. When you get here, and there's specific transfer enrollment day. So on that day, you're there with other transfer students, and we go. Now, once you're here as a student, for any student, those transfer credits count. And yeah, so students that have more credits, accumulated credits toward their degree, or of K-State credits in general, they'll enroll sooner than those that have lower. So that, because then you want your seniors and juniors to have priority to get into those classes that they need to get into and the sections that work so they can finish off. So there is a priority based on accumulated hours, and transfer hours count toward that total.
Here's
one for you.
Here's a question from Joe, and I'm thinking about majoring in mechanical engineering, but I'm also interested in computer science. At what point would I have to choose between them to graduate in 4 years? Also, which would you suggest starting at it? Well, this is my totally biased opinion, because I'm a mechanical engineer, so I would pick mechanical engineering. I think it's a great degree program. You wouldn't have to make a decision right away. I mean, for most of our degree programs, that first semester is going to work for any major. So you definitely have the first semester, and I would probably say between mechanical and computer science, because computer science has a lot of free science electives. You can kind of choose which science you take. You're probably also okay for that whole first year. But I would definitely, because it's not a requirement in mechanical engineering, it's very specific, right? It's not a requirement to take any computer science classes. We have our own sort of like computer engineering courses that are within the mechanical curriculum, but you don't take a computer science, but they'll count for an elective in mechanical engineering.
Yes.
So I would definitely, in that first year, I'd start out in mechanical and make sure you take at least one computer science class that will count towards your mechanical degree, but it'll also give you a good idea about how you feel about programming and the curriculum. If you already have a lot of programming experience, you might want to try branching out into some of the other computer science classes, and that would be a great question to sort of see which sort of computer science course is the best fit in that first semester or first year at K-State, so you can help make that decision.
Someone asked about getting prepared. For any student taking programming courses, whether before they get here or both, is a very good investment in time. Just not that you're going to be someone who's doing all the coding later on, but just understanding logic flow and how programs work is going to be to your advantage in all aspects of your work and professional life. So I would highly encourage anyone to start learning some programming. And if you don't have that option before you get here, there's some good entry-level programming courses that we have here. And again, work with your advisor to make sure that those are going to count towards your degree, but those would be very, very good to do.
Yeah, and even if you don't have a course you take, there's lots of great online resources,
yes.
Right? They have Scratch and Scratch Junior. my son, he's in elementary school, but he just loves Scratch Junior, and that he can program and that his dad can't even figure out the programs. It just makes him laugh and laugh and laugh, right? So there are other resources out there just so you can get a little programming. Again, it's that logic flow. It's understanding what other people are talking about. It's you'll use programs later, maybe MATLAB, or even it's going to help you later to use the programming functions in Excel, right? Mm-hmm. There's all kinds of ways that you're going to translate those skills later on, and it's just going to be helpful to you.
So here's one. How hard are engineering classes? For me, they were hard. Now, that was quite a long time ago, but I spent a lot. I mean, they were hard, but I enjoyed them. I mean, not all. There were some, okay. There were some I didn't like as much as others, but I just learned to study. You know, and the big thing is you gotta spend time studying. We have resources here, as we talked about SAS, to help you get through. Just have a mindset. It's going to be a challenge. I'm going to knuckle down. And one of the most important things, find study partners. Get a cohort of friends that you're going to study with together, because you're going to learn from each other.
Absolutely. It's really important. And I guess I would have to qualify what hard is. Are all your engineering classes going to be a huge challenge that you don't know how to overcome? No. Some of them will be, and mm-hmm. that's okay, right? But most of them are going to be work. You're going to have to put There's in work. The time. There's mm-hmm. work to them. Some of them are also going to be really challenging. And what you're going to find, if you find a good study group of friends, ones that are very challenging for you aren't challenging for your friends. So you can be the one that kind of to sort of get yourself through the work, because if something's not challenging, it can be hard to do the work. You work with your study group, and for that class, you're the one kind of showing your peers what to do. Here you go. Here's how we're going to get through this problem. And then all of a sudden, right, for me, that was physics, right? Physics, I was the one, let me tell everybody how to do this. Then came chemistry, and it was like, please help me. So it's everybody's going to be a little different, but if you get a great cohort of students, it is really gonna help you out.
Okay. I think we've covered all the questions that we've gotten. We wanna thank you for your time. We really appreciate your participation. We look forward to seeing you here at orientation and enrollment. And we know that for any student, choosing a campus, a college, and a degree program, those are big decisions. But we've got great facilities, we have great faculty, and really strong support services. And we think that your future here at K-State will be well worth your time, and you're going to enjoy it. I think we're wrapping up.
Yes, so I think we're going to go ahead and wrap up. Thank you so much for all your questions. If you have additional questions, please email us at engineering@k-state.edu or give us a call. We're happy to answer your questions. And we understand that you're going to continue to have questions and that new questions are going to pop up. We hope that K-State and the College of Engineering are your top choice. And we look forward to all students being here on campus next fall. And like I said, really, you really can reach out to us or save your questions for when you come for enrollment or at any point in time. And we wish everybody to stay safe and to have a really great night.
Yeah. Have a nice evening.